of staunch Republicans have come out in support of Vice President Biden's candidacy, among them Miles Taylor, who served as chief of staff for the Department of Homeland Security during the Trump administration. Taylor says that what he witnessed inside the White House was terrifying, and the U.S. is less secure because Trump is president. And Miles Taylor joins us now. Miles, thanks for joining us. The president tweeted today that he doesn't know you. He called you a disgruntled employee. You responded by tweeting a photograph of you with the president at the Resolute desk in the Oval Office. You said you have stories to tell. You've described what you saw as terrifying. What is the most important thing that the American public needs to know, you think?
Well, Jake, thanks for having me, first of all. I think the thing I would say is this. Anytime Donald Trump finds out that someone doesn't share his views or opposes him, he really, really quickly finds a way to say, I don't know that person. It finds a way to disown that person. So this wasn't a surprise. It was expected. And frankly, I think the best way for me to make that a little bit clear is to spend the next few weeks, the next few months talking about my experiences in this administration. But look, I would leave the American people with this and a very simple picture. At the end of the day, the man with his finger on the nuclear trigger is a man whose mind is not on his job on a daily basis. That is alarming, and that isn't something that just a handful of folks in the administration felt. Now, I may be one person speaking out. You're going to see more people in the coming weeks, Jake, but what they're going to tell you is that this was a widespread sentiment in the administration, and I can tell you, having talked to friends today in the administration who messaged me to say, thank you for speaking out, that there are a lot of folks very close to the president who still feel this way about him, about his leadership, and about a desire that he not have a second term in office.
You have said that the president exploits the Department of Homeland Security for his own political purposes. After you said that, I wondered what you maybe thought of the time that U.S. Park Police tear gassed protesters at Lafayette Square before the Trump photo op in front of the church. Is that the kind of exploiting that you're talking about?
I want to get to that in just one second, Jake, but I'll give you an even more recent example. I just got word within the past hour that a White House liaison employee at the department has been directed to go around to dig up dirt on me. Now, look, I'm fine with that. I can handle it. But here's the point. The administration, within hours of me speaking out about this, is already using taxpayer dollars for political purposes at the department. That just goes to show you that they can't break out of this cycle. Now, when it comes to tear gassing, that wasn't a surprise to me either. I mean, the fact that the president would allow that to happen in order to advance a political photo op was not only sort of to be expected, it was similar to something else that we saw earlier in our time at the department. In fact, I distinctly remember an incident at the southwest border. We had a case where we had a number of migrants charging a border station. Now, what normally happens is Border Patrol has to do crowd control measures to protect officers on the line, so limited tear gas was used to make sure that facility wasn't charged. When Donald Trump saw that on TV, he actually thought what we were doing was starting just to gas migrants across the border as a tactic. In fact, he immediately called the Secretary of Homeland Security to say, this is great, I love what you're doing, keep it going. He thought gassing was a policy when really it was a safety measure in that one moment for officers. I think that tells you a lot about the president's character, and that's why I think this is a character election. It's not about the policies, it's not about the politics, it's about the man that we're voting for. And in the time that I got to serve in that administration, I realized Donald Trump was not the man that we needed to be commander-in-chief.
You've also described President Trump as someone who has difficulty focusing on doing the job. You worked at the Department of Homeland Security. Can you give us an example of that dealing with Homeland Security, a president unable to focus on American lives, some sort of situation that you may have witnessed?
Yeah, Jake, we could probably go on all night with examples, but I'll just tell you one. I mean, one day I walked into the Oval Office to give the president a brief. I think this was fall of 2018. We had Hurricane Florence bearing down on the United States. It was coming towards the Carolinas on the coast. We sat there and we were briefing the president on the storm track. We were briefing the president on the damage that we expected and also our concerns about significant loss of life if he didn't tell Americans to evacuate. At first, I thought the president was very focused. I thought he was really paying attention to the briefing. He was studying the foam board that had the picture of the storm track. And then he turned to me and he said, you know, I've got a question. Yes, Mr. President. He said, do the hurricanes always spin this direction? He meant counterclockwise. Now, that's called the Coriolis effect. Same thing that causes toilets to spin the other direction in Australia, a follow-up question he also had. But this is what the president was focused on. Americans were in the path of a deadly hurricane. He needed to get out there and tell them to evacuate, and he was just marveled at the way that hurricanes spin. In a way, a third grader might, learning about earth science. This is the president that we're talking about to keep us safe.
The Senate Intelligence Committee issued its final report on Russian election interference earlier today. I know the president doesn't like hearing about this issue. Is his reluctance to accept the fact of interference by the Russians, as ascertained by the intelligence community, does that put U.S. security at risk, and if so, how?
Look, we saw it firsthand. And we saw it firsthand because we were quite literally told, do not bring up issues related to Russia with the president. It might be counterproductive. In fact, one of the former White House chiefs of staff told us that we should avoid bringing up the topic of Russia with the president. Here's the problem with that, Jake. When we were in 2018, driving towards the midterm elections, it was very clear that our number one homeland security concern was the possibility that the Russians might do again what they did in 2016. So what does that mean? You want the president of the United States to be very vocal and to say publicly, Russia better not meddle in our elections or they are going to be stiff consequences. The president didn't want to do that. In fact, he was infuriated at the suggestion that anything was being done on the subject. We couldn't get him to focus on it. The Secretary of Homeland Security would call him about it. We tried to schedule meetings about it. And in fact, in one meeting we scheduled on the topic, instead of actually focusing on the potential threat to the election, the president wanted to talk about how many counties he had won in 2016, rather than talk about the counties across the country that we were worried about the Russians targeting in our midterm elections. That's how severe this problem is. He's not focused on the threat. He's not focused on the reality. And I think, frankly, it's time to move on. And Jake, if I can add one last thing, I'm speaking about this as a lifelong Republican, okay? I had hopes that this president would live up to expectations, or even those who didn't have high expectations for him, that he might be able to do his job effectively with support. That didn't come out the way that we had planned. And I think at this point, it's a time for us to put country over party, and I hope other Republicans will do the same.
I do want to give you one other opportunity to respond to something that Jared Kushner, the president's son-in-law and a top advisor, said. He basically said that you're a nice kid, but you weren't up to the job. Take a listen.
It makes a lot of sense to me that he's endorsing Joe Biden. When he was working at the Department of Homeland Security, no wall was built and the border was wide open. That's why the president changed up the team there.
What's your take on that?
First, Jake, I'm going to say this. I'm born and raised in Indiana, so I hope Jared still thinks I'm a nice kid. And I'm not going to get into any commentary about Jared. I mean, my goal here isn't really to condone people by name in the administration, other than the man whose name is going to be on the ballot. Jared's name won't be on the ballot, but I will say this. We did everything within our power when we were in the department to enforce the law and support the 250,000 men and women on the front lines that protect this country every day. Sometimes that meant pushing back against the president. Sometimes that meant saying no. And if what folks in the White House are upset about is that we said no, I actually take it as a badge of honor that he thinks it was time to change out that team. I will make one other thing clear. I wasn't fired from the administration. I left months later on my own accord, despite the fact that they wanted me to stay. But there came a point, Jake, where saying no was no longer enough, and it was time to get out. And I hope that good people who are there will stay in and try to keep things on the rails. But if the president's reelected, the guardrails will be gone, and he will try to implement a vision that I think is much more damaging to our nation's security than even what we've seen in the last 4 years.
Like what?
I'll tell you this. There are people serving very close to the president that have told me verbatim, we should expect, quote, shock and awe if the president wins a second term. You will see a flurry of executive orders. You will see the president pull out of foreign alliances. You will see the president align with dictators around the world. And if right now we're less safe because we have fewer friends and stronger enemies than before, you can expect to see that on steroids in another 4 years of the Trump administration.
All right, former Department of Homeland Security Chief of Staff Miles Taylor, thank you so much for your time today.